The electric guitar defined rock and roll, giving it a sound that was completely different from any other music. What is it about the electric guitar that has made it the symbol of an era?
To understand why the guitar became so much a symbol of a generation, you have to pick one up, hold it, plug it into a Marshall stack and hit a chord, and then you know.
When you're playing the guitar, it's an extension of your passions.
And the fact that six strings can be used in so many different ways.
It's an extension of myself, it's part of me.
I think it's like telling a story. You got to have a punchline.
In some fashion, you wanted to communicate your feelings to somebody, you know, what you had to say. You wanted to talk to somebody, you didn't know how to do it, or somebody just wouldn't listen, you know, until you had the guitar in your hand.
So what would rock and roll be like without the electric guitar? Without the electric guitar, no rock and roll. No way. It is a complete entity of music. You can play the chord, you can play the melody, you can accompany yourself. It's the perfect musical instrument.
And I was going to teach this friend of mine how to do this. And he couldn't do it. So I said, you know, pardon the thing, but you have to say just, hey, motherfucker, you know. You're always cursing, and you're always praying, and you're always making love. It ain't do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, si, do. If there's about 100 million musicians, most of them sound a lot alike, but there's about 100 who you immediately, from one note, you can tell who they are. When you get inside the note, you immediately put your fingerprints on it. You know, you're making your own individual, unique statement. Your sound really comes from within. The guitars and the amplifiers, it's an extension. I really believe it's a God-given thing. I don't think it's something you can just chip and polish and work on it like that. I think it's something that you're born with.
Well, the concept of a guitar hero, I think, relates to sort of the concept of a Greek hero or somebody who is somewhat superhuman, a demigod of some kind who attains a certain place in the universe and people look to him as something very special. Of course, everybody wants to be different, so the guitar hero is in some way like the actor or the race car driver, somebody who's done something that nobody else can quite do.
When I was about 15, 16 years old, I could turn on the radio and play along with anything I heard. And I'm going, hey, I kind of know what I'm doing here, I guess. I remember Alex used to go out on a date or something at 7 o'clock. And I'd be sitting there playing guitar on the edge of my bed, you know, just jamming, learning stuff, doing my own stuff. 8 hours later, he'd come strolling in. I'd be sitting in the same place, still playing. I don't know how to explain, but it's the bug bit me. Big time.
I think when the Moors brought it over to Spain, this thing that's sort of shaped like a beautiful woman, the Spaniards knew a good thing when they saw it.
It's just as sexy as hell. I don't think there's anything else really like a guitar. When I look at a shop window with guitars, and I still feel the way that I used to when I was a kid. You know, it's nose up against the glass.
It's just kind of like walking into a candy store and picking, you know?
The way the guitar smelled, very, very specific smell. It's like smelling the smell of grass that you remember from when you were a kid. It's that sort of thing. Very, it was very intense.
Oh, well, I always wanted a guitar from as long as I can remember. I remember seeing a picture of one in a magazine and saying to my dad, I want that. I used to play on tennis rackets and bits of wood. It's obsessive behavior, you know, of the very worst kind.
Yeah, I got my first electric guitar when I was 15, and that was it.
I was 9. My parents gave me a guitar instead of a bicycle, and I was really pissed off because that's not what I wanted.
Eventually, I got one when I was about 15, and I used to put it on the arm of a chair and put my head on it and fall asleep. And it's just really gone on from there, and I still fall asleep playing the guitar. And you can bend it like a voice. You know, you can make it talk in a way.
Some people hang them on their walls or bring them out like a fine bottle of wine.
I love them as works of art, and I love the sound they make. Mike Campbell and myself really have never gotten over this disease. I mean, we still scour the recycler to find vintage guitars. It's one of my, I guess it's almost a vice now, because we just love them.
Do you play all, I mean, do you actually play all these, or?
Well, I play them and I cherish them. Mm-hmm. This is the top of the heap right here. There's no question about it. Look at the flame on that one.
Yes.
Look, I mean, it's quite unbelievable. This one is just, it's perfect. 1959, you know, it just, you can, listen.
How much is this?
Just listen for a minute. The sustain, listen to it.
I'm not hearing anything.
You would, though, if it were playing. Oh, this is special too, it's a, look, see? Still got the old tagger on it. See, never even played it.
You just bought it.
Don't touch it.
I wasn't going to touch it.
No, don't touch it.
I was just pointing at it.
Well, don't point even.
Don't even point.
No, it can't be played. Never. I mean,
can I look at it?
No, no. You've seen enough of that one.
The electric guitar dates from the 1930s, when acoustic instruments were first wired for sound. Soon, two inventors, Leo Fender and Les Paul, were experimenting with new types of guitars that could cleanly amplify a plucked string, even at a high volume. To the big beat of jump and blues bands, their electrified instruments added an equally big noise that became synonymous with rock and roll.
It was 1941. I had been deep into experimenting with semi-solid body guitar. And I finally said, look, for once and for all, I'm going to prove the point. And I would proceed to build this solid body, which I call the log, an electric guitar. And the wings that I just hitched on here with this little bracket, I put this thing, put it together, and went in there, and nobody noticed that I was playing a solid body guitar, and they loved it. By 1950, the Gibson people said, Les, can you come to Chicago? We want to do something about this electric guitar. I didn't realize the electric guitar was about to become a monster. We'll be fighting in the streets.
It's a weapon, really, above everything else. It was a weapon which had a number of different values, you know. The loudness of it was very important. The gun-like thing of it, the feeling of it was very important.
I remember seeing Townsend playing and doing these great windmills and jumping up in the air. Rock and roll is as physical as it is anything else, so the idea of jumping around or rolling around or whatever you want to do, set your guitar on fire, those are really all, you know, avenues to be explored.
The first time that I saw the Stones play, we were behind the curtain at the St. Mary's Ballroom in Putney, and we'd warm the audience up. The Stones were about to go on, and Keith Richard was limbering up. He was kind of getting down on his knees and getting his blood going. And one of the things that he did is he went like that with one arm and like that with the other arm. And as he was doing that with the other arm, the curtain opened. And he continued to do it as the curtain opened. So for about a year, I thought I was just copying my hero, literally just copying. Anyway, I then saw the Stones two or three times more, and Keith wasn't doing it. And I went up to him and I said to him something like, "Do you mind that I copied, you know, your arm swinging technique?" And he looked at me like I was a germ, and I realized that he didn't remember doing it. So I kept it in my act. It was very much an act, but it did actually in the end become a part of a guitar style which produced a sound that was unique.
You know, it's like when you learn to talk, you have to imitate your parents. That's what you do. So when you learn to play the guitar, you have to, I think, start by imitating other people. I don't think there is another way.
Anything you've ever heard comes out in what you play. So there's no way that you, it's actually yours. You just, you're a sponge that sucks it up and you put out bits that you don't even know how it gets there.
In the 50s, a generation of young musicians discovered the electric guitar. By plugging in and playing blues and country licks, they created rockabilly.
Country music was very simple. It only usually had three or four chords at the most. Elvis Presley walked right into that spot and said, "Okay, I'm a country boy, but I want rock. I want guys that play hard." So rockabilly, which was taking country music and giving it a very, very strong, very straight ahead beat, ended up coming out like.
Oh, well, I say blue moon up in Kentucky, just keep on shining. Shine on the one that's gonna live.
The first time I actually heard Scotty Moore playing was on the record Elvis recorded, Blue Moon in Kentucky. And his sound was very unique at that time because he was using an echo amp. That's how he actually perfected that sound. Playing the finger style with a lot of reverb and using the echo amp.
A guy like Elvis Presley, a guy like Ricky Nelson, you got a guy like James Burton. I mean, that guy's a stone country guitar player, but he rocks it, man. It's so solid.
Jimmy Burton was an absolute groundbreaker as a player.
I said hello, Mary Lou. Goodbye, heart. Sweet Mary Lou, I'm so in love with you. I knew Mary Lou.
When I went to work with Ricky Nelson, we recorded a song called Hello, Mary Lou. I get an awful lot of questions about that solo I played.
Thank you.
My style was created at a very early age. I'll demonstrate that with maybe a two-string chicken picking sound. I don't consider it rockabilly. What I did was I took like the country and the rhythm and blues and mixed it together and came out with more of a rock and roll feel.
Then you got a guy like Chuck Berry, who basically, boom, dropped into the scene, wrote 35 songs in 4 years, all classics, and invented a style of guitar playing that to this day everybody sort of has to pass through the Chuck Berry portal to get to the next step.
Johnny B. Good knocked me out, floored me. After that, that's when I knew what I wanted to do.
I learned to play guitar from this Chuck Berry record. I wore a lot of those out.
A lot of people did.
It wasn't typical R&B, but yet here was this, you know, different style of guitar, and Chuck played like horn riffs on his guitar.
Those early guitar licks were nothing in the world but bar blues licks that were just speeded up.
The thing that attracted me mainly to these early records, certainly the sort of rock and roll and blues records of that 50s period, was the atmosphere that was on them. And you could hear that there was so much urgency going on, and certainly with the blues, this sort of raw emotion.
As soon as the electric guitar became a feasible instrument and became affordable enough, the blues guys latched onto it immediately, because then their partner now could sing and speak with the same power.
You have a 12-bar, three-chord chain. That doesn't give you much to hide behind. I mean, you have to put your heart right up front, or you don't have anything but three little chords. And so you start realizing how subtly genius these old players really were.
The blues is sort of like Southern cooking. It may not have all of the ingredients that jazz would have, that rock and roll would have. You only have the three chord changes, so you got to be a very good chef to put each one of those in the right place. T-Bone Walker was the first guy that I ever saw play the guitar. The guitar seemed to sing with him, and I heard things like this. This guy could jump up and do a split, one leg this way and the other back there, and still have the guitar up there. I never did try that, but I did put the guitar up there, but trying that split, I didn't make it. I was so crazy about it. Well, I'm going to Chicago, but I can't tell. That's the way I am with the guitar. When these guys start playing all them notes, and I try to play them and can't play them, oh, probably wouldn't sound right for me anyhow. So I go the economy way. Try to make it sound like, you know, if I'm singing, I hear myself. When I'm not singing, playing. And then starting here in the U.S., with the kids starting here and a lot of the rock and roll players here, that the blues player, we wouldn't have lasted. We wouldn't have had any place to go, any place to play.
We were only trying to mimic what our American idols were doing, you know, in a way we were selling it back to them. Too much pain and too much sorrow, because I'll feel the same tomorrow. Well, this could be the last time, this could be the last time, maybe the last time, I don't know. Oh, no.
Responsible for Stones and the Yardbirds, they were all really heavily influenced, you know.
The Yardbirds, a British band popular in the 60s, introduced three legendary guitarists: Eric Clapton, Jimmy Page, and Jeff Beck.
Yeah, I have done other music after the Yardbirds, but anyway, somebody told me I should be proud tonight, but I'm not, because they kicked me out. They did. I said, fuck them.
the fact that there was this reputation with the Yardbirds. There'd been Eric with the Cream, and Jeff was out and about as well. And myself, all Yardbirds guitarists, but there was quite a keen importance put on this unit. And audiences were really looking out to see what I was going to do. With the Yardbirds, there were many areas within it of what we used to call freeform, which was improvisation. And I got quite a nice little, you know, little sort of portfolio of riffs and things.
I'm confused, so long it's not true. Why did a woman never bargain for you? Sweet little baby, say what you will. Don't lack so much when I send you the bill.
But it would be really different from the beginning of the tour to the end, because it was a whole area for improvisation. And so this is how you get the interplay between myself and Rob. Well, I did, and lo and behold, it became quite a feature. But I was pushing it every night, you know, to try and come up with something that I hadn't played the night before.
Because they have invented a template within which they work, and you know who that person is.
When I first heard Eric Clapton, I was shocked. He was so good, so young.
Everyone was sort of following Eric Clapton, which band he was in at the time. And everyone played a Les Paul and looked like Eric, you know, and wanted to play like Eric.
I tried very hard to sound like Clapton. He was my main inspiration on guitar. For some reason, Clapton was the only one that really touched me, the guy that made me want to play.
I would always make sure that I could find some place to put the blues in, so that I knew, even if nobody else did, that I was still at one foot.
Pete said to Eric, I want you to go to the movies with me. And Eric went, what? You know, okay. And they sat in the darkness of a movie theater, and Townsend told Clapton, I've just seen this guy who's going to put us all out of work, man.
Out of the blue comes a Jimi Hendrix.
Appeared.
You know, it was like hearing somebody from Mars playing the blues, you know.
Being. He was like from space.
And yet, accompanied by these incredibly wild noises, there was some kind of strange alchemy going on. He was an alchemist, you know.
Every possible vector that anybody could.
You know, something that was very, very close to ballet.
Oh, he slept with his guitar.
Something else. It was an extension of what he was doing.
There's no doubt about that the moving of a driving beat is something that's very, very, very sexual. And because the electric guitar became the symbol of that music, there was a very strong connection between the body rhythm and the electric guitar.
I tend to think of the guitar as the instrument of rock and roll, because it's an extension of what you've got between your legs.
People thought I was weird because I would stay home on weekends, on Friday and Saturday night, play my guitar. But then when I got good at playing guitar, boy, I got old pussy I wanted.
I think if you're looking for an example of this sexual being playing a guitar, one of the first guys that comes to mind is Slash, the guitar player for Guns N' Roses. Everything that comes from him comes from his guitar. He looks at it kind of like a part of his own body.
A musician can do to a woman a lot of times what a lover cannot do to a woman. I'm very flattered that you're here after the gig and you're knocking on my door and you're really beautiful and all that, you know, but at the same time, I cannot do to you what my music does to your soul.
There's something very romantic about that. That's part of the romantic process. Your guitar reflects that. We were talking to Pete Townsend and about Jimi Hendrix, how they looked at their instruments. If you're willing to destroy something that's so much part of you, that speaks volumes about your personality.
Who said I broke beautiful guitars? Who said they were expensive? Who said I really broke them? What do you know? What's it got to do with you? My fucking guitars.
It's the brute force of electric guitar. That E chord on an electric guitar, it's just bright red. Edge always had this thing about notes, that they're really expensive and that you shouldn't spend them, you know, unless you really have to.
If you have a great guitar and a great amplifier, I believe you can conquer the world.
Anybody sees a Fender Stratocaster or an electric guitar, that's a symbol of freedom, choice, a whole generation of a country that allowed people to have free thought. That's an incredible instrument, it's an incredible symbol.
Like you roll a wagon wheel.
In 1994, three generations of electric guitar players gathered at the House of Blues to honor Les Paul and to celebrate the instrument that he helped create.
The guitar is like an old friend. It has been many times like the only friend that was really there for me, there with me.
This is art. This is not, you know, something that anybody can do. You know, go ahead, anybody in this room, pick it up. You know, I mean, it's not easy.
This guitar here is such a pal. It's a psychiatrist, it's a doggone bartender, it's a housewife. This guy is everything. Whenever I find that I got a problem or something, I'll go pick my guitar up and play it. It's the greatest pal in the whole world.
Just let me hear some of that rock and roll music. Any old way you choose it. Got a backbeat, you can't lose it. Any old time you use it. It's gotta be rock and roll music. If you wanna dance with me. If you wanna dance with me. I have no kick against modern jazz. Unless they try to play it too darn fast. And change the beauty of the melody. Until it sounds just like a symphony. That's why I go for that rock and roll music. Any old way you choose it. It's got a backbeat, you can't lose it. Any
there to hear him play a tango. I'm in the mood to dig a mambo. It's way too early for the Congo. So keep a rocking that piano so I can hear some of that rock.